single speaker, Mr. Charlie Clark. Mr. Clark is a journalist and a local historian. He writes a weekly column for the Falls Church News Press called Our Man in Arlington. He's the author of a recently published book, Arlington Chronicles, which I'm about halfway through and finding it very interesting. And he's going to talk to us today about some incidents in Arlington history. Charlie Clark.
Well, thanks, Carl. Carl plays many roles in Arlington County, and one of which is editor of the Arlington Historical Magazine. And it's thanks to his open-mindedness about 15 years ago when I first started writing for them that I was able to do a lot of original research on these topics that I'm going to discuss tonight. The motorcycle gang shootout in 1966 and the presence of the American Nazi Party in Arlington from 1958 to 1983. What unites those two topics is they both have to do with how Arlington has changed since the 50s and 60s. It was a lot more, you know, I want to be politically correct and sensitive, use some socioeconomic vocabulary, but, you know, the Arlington is a lot more affluent today than it was in the 50s and 60s. There was a lot more blue-collar families that could afford to live in Arlington back then, and Arlington resembled a lot more of the Deep South, I would say, than it does today. It's been somewhat gentrified. I think everybody knows that. And these sort of class issues, I think, help explain why these two phenomena took place here. So the motorcycle gang shootout took place in June 14th. And I went through a lot of clippings from the Washington Post, Washington Star, Washington Daily News. Keep in mind that in 1966, the Washington Star and the Daily News were very important afternoon papers. They had a lot. They broke a lot of stories. And the Post had not yet really emerged as a more widely read. Northern Virginia Sun, of course, would have covered all this real well. I also, in researching it, I approached the Arlington County Police Department, and they had a listserv of retired police officers, and I put out a bulletin, and I got lots of nice contacts from retired cops who experienced this, including one who was one of my secret sources who declined to be identified. And then I also interviewed the ringleader of the shootout, a guy named Wayne Hager, who I've gotten to know over the years, and I'll be talking a little bit more about him. So the gangs, the main gang that existed for quite 6 or 8 years before that started in Maryland was called the Pagans. And they were an East Coast motorcycle gang. They aspired to be the version of Hell's Angels in this region. And they would hang out in Arlington at places like Tops, the Tops drive-in, George Mason Drive on the highway. They would drag race on Route 110 going over to Crystal City. They'd hang out at Whitey's down there on Washington Boulevard. And they would drag race on Old Lee Road near Walker Chapel, too. And the cops all knew them. They all were fond of some of these police officers. One of them was Officer Metz. They called him Muffler Metz because I guess his car was loud. And a lot of these guys played together as boys. And they were somewhere between 18 and 25 years old. And the big thing about them is that they're not college-bound types. And they had blue-collar jobs as Wayne Hager was a meat cutter at Safeway, and Tom Greenwood, who I met years ago, was a lawn seeder. And they would go to parties, and there would be a college-bound kid at the party, and they would go and beat him up. You know, it wasn't funny. It was serious. You know, there was real violence and real tensions. So Wayne Hager, as he explained it to me in several interviews I did with him, had the right motorcycle, and he would hang out at some of these pagan events at racetracks. But he refused to wear their colors. He didn't want to join. He was more independent. And there was some tension over that, and
he got in a fist fight with a guy named Frederick Dutch Burhans, who, by coincidence, his family lived next door to where I live now, and I always knew who he was there on Roosevelt Street. And they got in a, he was a member of the Pagans, later became the president, and they got in a fist fight, and Wayne began to resent the fact that this Maryland-originated gang was pushing their way around Arlington. So he decided, and then they firebombed his car, and they threatened to do more to his house. So Wayne decided he would form an alternative band of brothers called the Avengers. And here they are, a sample of it. And you'll notice that they have an apostrophe on their jacket. Motorcycle gangs really should each have a copy editor, you know, to explain the problem. But Wayne went downtown to the ABC print store and had 30 or 40 of these jackets made and started this sort of instant gang. And so then there was a confrontation at North Beach, I think it is, Maryland, a small beach town, with a Pagan named Samuel Frederick, and he got in a fist fight with Hager, and he had to go to the hospital. And on the way home from the hospital, he was driving his own car, he was killed, truck hit him. So the Pagans were very angry and blamed Wayne Hager. So they started to put out threats on him, and they all agreed to meet at what was called The Lot, which was the Lee Harrison Shopping Center. It was different back then. It had a drug veneer, it had Gifford's Ice Cream, which is now Joe's Pizza, and it had an A&P, which is about where the Pie Tanza pizza is now. And the Safeway was actually in a slightly different configuration too. It's been rebuilt over the years. So the police got wind of this, and at 5 o'clock, this is all based on police records and the newspaper clips I read, at 5 o'clock they began to assemble, and Commonwealth's attorney Hassan had decided that they couldn't arrest anybody until they had a crime had been committed. They couldn't arrest them preemptively.
And as the gang started to assemble there, two of them showed up, Tom Greenwood, another on Illinois Street, which is right near that Petco on Lee Highway, across from the Sunoco, with two sawed-off shotguns, which are illegal. The cops promptly arrested him. So Tom Greenwood doesn't get to be in the shootout. And about 11 o'clock, when the PM, Friday night, when the cops are changing shifts, the shots ring out. The Avengers had arrived at Lee Harrison. They had 25 millimeter automatic rifles, an AR-15 rifle, brass knuckles, hunting rifles, clubs with nails, pictures of which would later show up in the paper. This police chief Mackey was driving home on Lee Highway at 11 o'clock night in Cherrydale, and he gets this bulletin, turn around and come back. So there's a lot of detail about how the who fired the first shots from behind Giffords and across the street and all this. And Wayne Hager dropped to the ground, and he was a little bit scared, I think, but he considered it a natural reaction. And 100 shots, they figured out later, were eventually fired. 11 o'clock night on a Friday night. And phenomenally, not one person was injured. And the police chief was quoted as saying, "This was the worst shooting in Arlington since 1865. Nobody was hurt." So, I'll show you how a political cartoonist made fun of it, compared it to Vietnam. I think that appeared in the Washington Daily News. And so, 2 days later, so Hager hightailed it out of the scene. He took his guns and his girlfriend and drove his Impala back home to his house on Roosevelt Street, and hid the guns and came back and watched the cops do their investigation. And Hager filed murder charges against one of the Pagans, a guy named Warner Ray Cockerville. And then as the cops were arresting people, 2 days later, two of the Avengers, Morley and Thomas, were arrested at the pawn shop in Lion Village for trying to purchase 200 rounds of ammunition. So there are pictures of the guys being brought to court Here they are, chained together, handcuffs, Pagans and Avengers together. Can't humiliate them. That's Cockerell, the far right, the real tall guy. He's about 6'9". He lived out in Vienna. And so the county board then had gotten a big philosophical debate over how to respond to this. And you had Chairman Harold J. Casto, a lot of people remember him. I grew up with his son. And Ken Haggerty, who I interviewed for this story, they had one idea of they wanted a tougher response from the county about how this could be prevented in the future. And County Manager Bert Johnson had written a short memo about how we ought to rethink some of the tactics on preemptive policing. And Leo Urbanski and Tom Richards, the other two board members, they agreed with Commonwealth Attorney Hassan that they would cancel the meeting because they didn't want to destroy some of his evidence for the coming trial. And there was this whole issue about how whether there should be gun control. And by the way, Dr. Haggerty in 2008 had changed his view on gun control. He was all against it in 2008, but back in 1966, he thought we ought to crack down on some of the illegal gun ownership. Hassan tried to successfully push through a new ordinance that allowed more preemptive arrests based on property owners' fears of alarming threats. So these Pagans were and Avengers were put on trial on charges of disorderly conduct and incitement to riot. And they were sentenced by Judges Thomas Dodge, George Dodge, who is a member of this group, and Judge Burton Kramer, the well-known juvenile court judge, and his successor is here tonight, Judge Roussis. They got fines of $250, 30 days in jail, and many of the charges were then dropped, including the murder charges against Wayne Cockerville. So afterwards, this all happened in a period of several days. There was a big gangland funeral for this Samuel Frederick, whose death by car accident had prompted this shootout. And the gangs, a lot of both members of both gangs assembled there. Dutch Burhans would go on to become president of the Pagans, and he was murdered in 1980 in Fairfax County, probably a drug deal. And Tom Greenwood, who would go on to have a little more trouble with the law, he and Wayne Hager would reconcile. They were boyhood friends, and Greenwood had told Hager that he never really meant to do him any harm, but he was under pressure from the other Pagans. And a lot of people have forgotten that these are some of the weapons that the police confiscated that night. And this episode was a little bit lost to history. I mean, I had always heard about it. I was only 13 years old at the time. I was a seventh grader at Williamsburg. And that's why it was so fascinating to recapture it. And we printed it in the Arlington Historical Magazine, and then it was adapted in Arlington Magazine just about 2 years ago. And somebody wrote in saying, you know, I thought I dreamt all that. I couldn't believe it. But here it was good to see it vindicated. A guy I went to Yorktown with as a kid, he found one of the bullet shells and presented to his neighbor. And a year after my piece came out, I got a nice letter, which we printed in the Arlington Historical Magazine, by a Yorktown student named Bill Ingram, whose brothers I knew. And he said that this whole episode changed his life because he had a fancy motorcycle. And the Pagans and the Avengers were always trying to recruit him. And he had the two voices in his conscience at war because his father was telling him, you're gonna go to college. And he was saying, no, I'm gonna hang around in Arlington and be with the Pagans. And his father went out and he went off to college, and he's ever grateful for that. So let me switch gears a little bit and talk about the American Nazi Party. A lot of people are still shocked that the Nazis were here. This is Dutch Burhans, his police. I got a lot of the police reports and arrest records when I did the research. All right, and there's that apostrophe. I keep wanting to just edit it out, but. Okay, so if you were in Arlington in the early 60s and you were driving through Boylston on Randolph Street, where there's now a big high rise, you would have seen this house. And it was pretty shocking for my parents to try to explain it. And George Lincoln Rockwell had arrived as the founder of the American Nazi Party. He arrived here in 1958. So this is just 13 years after World War II, when a lot of Arlington residents had fought against the Nazis. And Rockwell was, he was born in Bloomington, Illinois. He was the son of Broadway entertainers. His father was a radio personality. So he grew up at dinner parties with Groucho Marx and Fanny Bryce. It's very strange. And his father sent him off to fancy prep school and then Brown University, where he studied commercial art. He served in World War II, became a Navy pilot, and he would later serve in the Korean War, but rose to the rank of lieutenant commander. He was stationed in Iceland during that Navy service, and he already had a wife and a couple kids, but he met this Aryan, beautiful Icelandic woman, and dropped his wife and married her, and they went off on a honeymoon in Berchtesgaden, Germany, which is Hitler's retreat. And they read Mein Kampf, and he got converted. So he came back to the States, and he was looking for a financial backer, and he found it in a wealthy heir from Baltimore named Harold Arrowsmith, whose father was an Episcopalian rector at one of the churches in Baltimore. It's a very strange story. So Arrowsmith, and he has a couple other backers, set up Rockwell in Arlington, Virginia. Well, why Arlington? Well, it's near D.C., easy to get publicity, the media's there, easy to stage protests. So he set him up in this house, which is still there at 6212, I believe, Williamsburg Boulevard, right at the intersection of Sycamore Street. And they put a big banner and strobe spotlight in the window, so when you drove by, you could see the swastika in the living room. And a lot of kids in that era remember driving by that house in the school bus and seeing the swastika. And one of my Yorktown friends, who was a student at Nottingham in the late 50s, remembers having a little blonde-haired friend named Ricky Rockwell. And, age six or so. And one day, Ricky Rockwell came up and said, "I'm sorry, we're leaving town. I'll never see you again." And that was it. So Rockwell's wife was divorcing him and taking the kids back to Iceland. What was going on? So in that house on Mason Boulevard, Commonwealth Attorney Hassan, he shows up again. He raided it with his deputy, Commonwealth Attorney Earl Schaefer, who I got to talk to about this just a couple of years ago. He died a year ago, so. And they found, they were looking for weapons. They found very few, but what they did find was a birthday cake honoring Hitler's birthday, and Rockwell offered him a piece of the cake, and Rockwell took a picture of them in his own living room raiding and got it published in the newspapers and on the television news. So what became clear early on is that Rockwell, who was a pretty charismatic guy, was a publicity hound. So the Nazis then set up shop, and they had a whole agenda of spreading hate literature. They picketed, the first thing they did was phone in a bomb threat to the Unitarian Church, which is there today at Route 50 and George Mason. And the coverage shows all the clergy in Arlington all united to condemn that. It's very, very touching. And they put out hate literature, doing a parody of Anne Frank, which I won't dignify with the details. They picketed a visit by Israeli Prime Minister Ben Gurion to the White House. They picketed the movie Exodus. They picketed performances by Sammy Davis Jr., who was black and Jewish and married to a white woman. That was about three strikes against him from their point of view. They went up to New York City in 1960, and they wanted to organize a rally on the 4th of July, and got in a big legal battle with the mayor of New York City, Robert Wagner, and Robert Wagner lost that battle on First Amendment grounds. Bob Dylan mentioned, or George Lincoln Rockwell, in one of his songs. Alex Haley interviewed Rockwell for Playboy magazine. And you remember Alex Haley would go on to write The Roots, the book and TV series. But Playboy purposely sent this African-American author who had ghostwritten the memoirs of Malcolm X, which is, and to read the Playboy interview is fascinating, sort of see the way Rockwell handles himself. And he had ambitions to run for president in 1972. He did run for governor of Virginia in 1965, and he got about 6,300 votes, I think, is the figure I used. So what did Arlington do about this? This is what's sort of a fascinating story, but people were divided. The Jewish community was divided. Some thought that he should be ignored because there are clearly publicity hounds. And there's a famous picture of Rockwell picketing Mario's Pizza, which I have here. I'll go ahead and explain it. This is Rockwell at the sit-in at the Cherrydale Drug Fair in June of 1960. And these are Howard University's Dion Diamond, who, by the way, just linked to me in the other day. I'm so honored that he's still in touch with me because I interviewed him about a year and a half ago. But he and some other blacks from downtown organized this sit-ins along Lee Highway. And so as soon as word got out in the media about that, the Nazis show up because they know there's a camera there and they want to be in it as well. I also tried to get these other guys in the picture identified, and I sent it around to a lot of W&L graduates from 1960 and 61, but nobody would own up to being there. Here's the Mario's Pizza shot. This is the kind of thing. Now, Mario's Pizza, and I grew up in Rivercrest with the Levine family. I'm still in touch with Alan, who just sold Mario's about 2 years ago. But Howard Levine was Jewish, and he somehow, the Nazis found this out and had it in for him, and so this is one of their protests that got a lot of coverage. So the question would be, should they be ignored, or should they be covered in the newspapers, and should people protest them? And the Herman Obermeyer, how many remember who Herman is? Good, I'm so glad to see you. I'm still friends with Mr. Obermeyer. You know, I read his paper when I was a kid, and I knew a lot of people who delivered it and everything, but I didn't really get to know him until the last 2 or 3 years. And he has a tremendous set of files on the American Nazi Party in Arlington and has written widely on it, but he wants to write some more stuff, and I've been helping him a little bit. He's 92 years old, he lives here in Arlington. And he parted ways with the other newspapers around town, the Post and the Star and the Washington Daily News, had an informal quarantine. This has been written up in the Journalism Review, saying we're not going to give the Nazis any more publicity than they deserve. And Herman felt obligated to cover them blow by blow, which he did. And I have his collection of clippings, which he published as a book. You can actually order that on Amazon. And there's a lot of, there was a group called the Concerned Citizens, and it was organized by the head of the Civic Federation, Plank. I don't even remember that family name. They lived over on Pershing Drive. Carolyn Plank, I think is her name. And the minister at First Presbyterian Church, Gregory Yount, and some others. A lot of Jewish parents of my classmates named Leibowitz and Nachman. I remember Nachman's bicycle shop used to be on Lee Highway across the McDonald's, moved to Falls Church. They were all in the Concerned Citizens. And they wanted, they worked with the National B'nai B'rith and the Anti-Defamation League too. This is the days before the internet, you know, you had to compile research from clippings and out-of-town papers, much harder to get. So you had a lot of national networks compiling information on these hate groups. And they wanted to focus on trying to nailed the Nazis for not having their proper business licenses. You know, they ran a printing press, for example, and they did the graphic arts for clients. And there was some question about whether there was an illegitimate child who died in the Nazis' houses, in one of their houses. And there was, you know, questions whether some social workers should investigate that. And Herman will tell you that the Jewish community gave him some flack. I mean, he would correspond with Rockwell to make news. I mean, he really wanted to keep tabs on them, and other people felt that they're the best ignored. So the Nazis continued to demonstrate that. This is a shot of them downtown on the Ellipse. And you can see the Arlington Randolph Street address there. Now, they had another location they called their barracks on Wilson Boulevard in an old, large, but kind of ramshackle home that the widow of an admiral named Kern owned. And she agreed to rent that to them in the early 60s. After they were evicted from the Randolph Street house, the IRS nailed the Nazis for failure to pay taxes. They owed about $7,500, and the IRS employee personally took down the sign that said "Help Fight the Black Revolution." Other county board members debated about whether to go after them on technicalities. There was certainly a lot of meetings about it, a lot of discussion. They did finally, Rockwell was always in court on alimony, you know, he never quite had enough money. And Nazis would also, when they moved to a new location, they would fool the real estate agents. You know, they had two or three other short-lived locations, and they would sign under an assumed name, and then the neighbors would learn who they were roommates with, and there would be controversy. But they ended up with the barracks, which today is the Upton Hill Regional Park. That was the top of that hill was the Nazi headquarters, and there's still a long pathway leading down from the top of that hill that you can see pictures of Rockwell walk traipsing down that. So the big drama happened on August 25th, 1967. Rockwell was in the Dominion Hills Shopping Center, right outside of Tom's Barbershop. Tom's is still there, and that's how I got some of my original research. I tracked Tom down. He's retired in Fredericksburg. I interviewed him a few times. He's probably the second to the last person to talk to Rockwell. He talked to him regularly, got his hair cut there. And Rockwell was in this laundromat, and there was a proprietor there named Ruth, I think. And he told her that she called him a gentleman later when she was interviewed. And she said, he said, "I forgot my bleach. I'll be right back." Those may have been his last words. So he goes out to his Buick, I think it is, Chevrolet maybe. And shots ring out from the top of the Dominion Hills Shopping Center. Rockwell collapses and dies instantly. Herman Obermeyer is proud that one of his reporters was one of the first on the scene, you know, within about 15, 20 minutes, police radio, et cetera. So a guy jumps off the roof and starts running through the neighborhood. And all these neighbors spot him and they give chase. And this assassin, as they called him, was later arrested at Harrison Street and Inglewood at a bus stop. And the police all knew the Nazis by face. So he's standing at this bus stop with wet trousers down from his knee down. So that was a clue that he had waded into some water and disposed of his weapon. This is a German pistol. And sure enough, that night, one of the police officers waded into 4 Mile Run right there near Bonnier Park and found the weapon. So the assassin was not some kind of anti-Nazi person, but a fellow Nazi. And he went by the name of John Patler, which was not his real name. It was a Greek name, Patsoulos. But Patler was his nom de guerre. It's supposed to sound like Hitler. And he was about 26 years old. And He had been one of Rockwell's proteges. There's pictures of him together with Rockwell. And I'll get to that in a sec. It later came out that his wife, that Rockwell had propositioned his wife, and that may have been one of the causes of tension between them. So at the trial, Patler was defended by Helen Lane. Now, how many remember who Helen Lane is? There you go. Okay. Well, Mrs. Lane was a school board member in 1958, and she and Bob Peck were on the school board, and they were very much against the desegregation movement going on in the late 50s. And I think there's those issues are intertwined there, because when you ask why were the Nazis tolerated in Arlington, it's not that very many people were really Nazis and were not loyal to America during World War II, but they were crudely fighting the battle against desegregation that a lot of people, just average Arlingtonians, backed at that time. It was a very different era back then. And so Helen Lane, who was a treasury clerk in the 50s when she was on the school board, she went off to law school in the early 60s and became an attorney. So in 1967, she's ready to defend Patler. And there was also a report by Drew Pearson in the syndicated column that Helen Lane had a printing press in her basement that printed Nazi literature and that she was a sympathizer. I tried to track that down. I even talked to the builder that dismantled her house, but I was never able to verify that. You have to decide whether you believe Drew Pearson. So at the trial, and there's a tape recording of the trial, which the late Earl Schaefer has in his basement. He promised he would get it for me, but it never happened. And my friend George Dodge would still like to track that down. But it has Commonwealth's attorney Hassan asking for the death penalty for Patler, and it has the verdict being read and the wife screaming. And he was found guilty, but he was sentenced to, I think it's about a dozen years in prison, and he ended up in a camp more than a high security prison, and for good behavior he got off in more like 7 or 8 years, sometime in the late 70s. I tried to track down Pat Sulo since he changed his name back, but I was unable to do that. So then after Rockwell's killing on the 25th, you had this worldwide coverage. This was in newspapers in Tokyo and Berlin and Argentina and London, all noted this passing. And as Herman Obermeyer says to me, how does this stumblebun bum make himself a world news story like that? You know, it's pretty phenomenal. So Rockwell, being a military veteran, he's eligible to be buried in a national cemetery, not Arlington Cemetery. So they choose Culpeper. Maybe you all have been down there. And so about 30 or 40 Nazis come from all over the country. There was really only about 50 or 60 total nationwide, maybe 20 or 30 in Arlington, but they always made the numbers look bigger. And they drove this hearse with a casket down to Culpeper, but the problem was they wanted to have swastikas and other Nazi regalia as part of the burial ceremony. Well, the Pentagon has regulations. No. So a Defense Department commander had to stand in the way of the hearse and say, this is not gonna happen. So this is all photographed, got a lot of news coverage too. So the hearse turned around and went back to Arlington, where they had Rockwell cremated, and his ashes ended up in Wisconsin. They're up there now in New Berlin. And Rockwell's will, which I have seen, it's in the Arlington Records Office. He died at $257 to his name. It's interesting that his mother always says that he really never was financially self-supporting, that she had to support him a lot of that time. He died at age 47. So 10 years later, the Nazis came back to the Dominion Hill Shopping Center and they had a ceremony commemorating his death. And there's pictures of the swastika they traced on the parking lot there. The Nazis, meanwhile, moved from the barracks on Wilson Boulevard to the building in Clarendon that is now the Java Shack, which is a fine coffee house. It has nothing to do with the Nazis. But that's where they stayed from 68 to 83. In 1977, there was some big racial rock-throwing episode between Nazis and the black activists there. They got a lot of police action. And the other episode that I'll recount, and before we open it up for questions, is the Nazis were determined to speak at Yorktown High School for something called White Pride Day. I don't know if you were on the school board back then, Mary Margaret. Maybe you were. But in 83, is that, were you on the back then?
Okay. No.
Okay.
But I remember in the 70s
they wanted to meet at Yorktown. Yes. Well, it started in about 71 when I was still a student at Yorktown, and they applied to hold this rally, and the school board had to decide, and there was all these complicated legal questions about whether they were a nonprofit and how big were they and whether it was a paid event, and it went to court, and it took 3 years. By that time, the Nazis had given up. And in 1974, so I mean, the courts ruled in favor of the Nazis with backing from the ACLU. The ACLU also backed the Nazis' right to bury Rockwell in the Culpeper Cemetery with regalia, too. It's interesting, unsuccessfully. So they won the court case, but it wasn't until 1983, which is when they actually went through with this plan. And this is a picture of Rockwell's successor, Matt Cale, at Yorktown. That's a classroom that I used to take classes in, speaking for White Pride Day. And in 1983, they moved to New Berlin, Wisconsin, and changed their name to the National White People's Socialist Party. And they still show up on the History Channel, but it's still a little bit of a shock to people that, you know, tranquil suburban Arlington was the scene of all this hate drama. So that's about all I have to say factually. What I want to do, though, Carl and the Committee of 100 people have a very good rule here where during the question period, please present your question in the form of a question, which is a good way to save time. But tonight is a little different because I'd be happy to answer anybody's questions, but I'd be delighted if people want to share comments or anecdotes or memories of these two episodes, and don't feel like you have to ask a question. So I believe John Richardson has a mic, and this gentleman here has a mic. Yeah, a lion. Thank you. So I'll go ahead and let them call on somebody. Yeah, go ahead. Oh, okay. Yes, sir, John.
Hello, everyone. My name is John Burroughs. And my church is the Farlington Methodist Church in Alexandria. It's been there forever. I think during this period of time, we had a relationship with Bethel Synagogue. Okay, back in the 60s or so, they were located on Washington Street. And they were building a new synagogue in Seminary Road, which they have today. And it wasn't quite finished. They needed places to have services. Short time afterwards, they had a rabbi who was a supporter of Martin Luther King. And the rabbi was against segregation and all this other stuff. And anyways, there were a group of people that placed crosses, burning crosses at the synagogue. And I'm wondering if that's the same period of time. I wonder if the Nazis were.
Well, 58 was the bomb threat.
Yes.
So I can't tell what era you're talking about. Would that be fair?
I can't.
Yeah, because Rodolf Shalom Temple was created in around that time, too. Spinoff from the Alexandria Bethel, so it would have been the same period. That's all I can say.
Interesting thing about your speech is that you mentioned some of the local churches that were supportive of people that didn't like the Nazis. And that's important too.
Okay, any other? Go ahead. Yes, George.
Yeah, Charlie. Thank you. Great job on the what happened in 1967 up at the Dominion Hills Shopping Center. But I'll tell you, I was entering the fifth grade at Ashland Elementary School, and I was up there the day that Rockwell got shot. And I also had my hair cut at Tom's Barbershop for years. Tom and Jim worked there. I will just go on to say that it was a 1958 Chevrolet. And after the shooting, Jim from the barbershop was one of the guys that chased Patler away from the shopping center. Didn't catch him, but he did.
That's great.
Yeah.
Eyewitness stuff, George. Thanks.
That's all I'll have to say about that.
Yes, this lady right here?
Yeah.
I have a loud voice.
Hi, I'm Ann Kelly, and at the time Rockwell was killed, I was Ann Merrill. I was working at Arlington Police Department on Mule Street for Inspector Bell, supervisor in the police records. And we, Inspector Bell had a little bit of a heart problem, so we had to get him something for that because he was going to talk to the press. But we were afraid that there would be a run on the jail when Pat was brought in. And, but he was very quiet. He was very non-committal, just as Rockwell was. A few times I saw him getting permits to be in parades in Arlington County. I don't ever remember. I remember them on Randolph Street. I only remember the sign saying White Socialist Party when they moved near Yule Street. And they had several demonstrations there. And they were always peaceful, except for the time that there were some rocks thrown. And it was usually at them. That was quite a day. But it wasn't as much of a problem as some of the other things that have happened in Arlington. I was really surprised. Luckily, it wasn't. Now, the Patler Avengers, I was a playground director at Westover Playground. I was in college in the 60s. And the Avengers, one pagan would try to come over and see who was hanging out at our playground. And because they would try to use their motorcycles on the baseball diamond.
Oh, wow.
And I guess that was for my police department days. I still had a strong voice and suggested they stop doing that. And they did break the rights that they caused. And I was not allowing any cuss words around the children. And they were very polite. And they were very, this one pagan would come by in his very dark leather jacket with 16 zippers. And we counted him one time. And we were very lucky that, and they were very polite to the children. I didn't think they were great examples, but they liked to come to Westover, and I think that very June date, a couple of them were waiting to go over near Gifford's at the Harrison.
Well, you know. Well, by the way, I'm reminded that Rex Thomas is here tonight. His father was an Arlington policeman, and he brought the actual Avengers jacket. And we have it right here. Yeah. Let's see. Just give me a second. Back on the Nazis, I also wanted to mention that in the 1976 bicentennial, the Nazi Party marched, you know, and they, because of the First Amendment, you know, they were given the permit like a lot of other groups. So. Yes, there's an essay on where he summarizes Mein Kampf,
And I believe it's in Herman Overmeyer's book that you can order on Amazon, and I have a couple copies even in my house. He does a little exegesis about it, and he can never really make up his mind whether he hated blacks or Jews or pretty disturbing. My theory about Rockwell is his motivation is that he was a charismatic guy, 6'3", had these flashing eyes, and he was a dynamic public speaker, very self-confident. And I think he noticed that he could get under people's skin. And I think he seemed to be sort of inured to criticism and insults. And I think he felt power when he would say shocking things filled with hatred, and a lot of the delicate people would be so stunned that somebody was voicing these thoughts that it gave him a sense of power. That's just my amateur psychologist analysis.
Yes, sir.
Cayman, yeah.
Hi, Charlie. It's Mona Honda. Great talk. I recently read a book titled Showdown by Thomas Smith. It's at Central Library. It's about the Redskins when they were the only segregated team in the NFL. I think they were the only team from 1952 through 61. There's a photograph of a Nazi over at the promenade near Stadium Armory with signs and then the armband. I'm guessing that's Rockwell and one of his lackeys. I was just wondering what you had discovered about the interaction between the American Nazi Party and Marshall's Redskins.
Wow. Well, keep in mind that the Redskins were the only team in the entire South. You know, you didn't have the Atlanta Falcons and the Jacksonville Jaguars and everything. So George Preston Marshall's he believed he was making a business calculation that his fans and his radio revenues would dry up if he integrated. So I doubt that he needed the Nazis' more aggressive hatred to keep that policy. That's just my analysis of it.
How about the other way around? Did you think Rockwell needed the Redskins to further his goals?
I didn't hear that any of them follow sports, you know. But I'll try and look. No, it's a good thought. I mean, like I said earlier, there's a lot of mainstream attitudes in 1958 and 1961 were for segregation in Arlington, and so it's not the Nazis were just more radical in their aggressive hatred. So I'll look that up for you. And, yeah. Yes, ma'am, Marjorie.
I'm Marjorie Hobart, and for a long time I was the executive director of the Arlington Education Association. And before we had our most recent elected school board, we had an appointed school board. And for a long time, you didn't know who was even trying to be appointed to the school board. And so the Teachers Association urged the county board to at least hold a hearing among the candidates who were interested in being appointed to the school board. And when the Washington Lee Auditorium was brand new, the second one that's no longer there anymore, who should show up but a Nazi who was running for the school board. And he was chilling. I don't remember a whole lot of what he said, but part of it was that he was going to replace physical education with close order drill.
Well, that's a good story, Mark. You know, the other thing, the Nazis would hang out at the Central Library. And there was a lot of patrons who were intimidated by him, and they had to set up some rules. And I still, you know, I've gone back to Central Library numerous times to grab the biography of Rockwell that's on the shelf there, and I use it. And there was always a little card in it from a current day Nazi, you know, inserted in there with a P.O. box up in New Berlin, Wisconsin. So. Yes, Jonathan.
I'm Rex Thomas's cousin, and I was born and raised in Arlington, and his father was my Uncle Chip, and he was an auxiliary police officer, meaning he had a day job, but if there was too much going on in the county for the police officers they had, they would call out to the auxiliary police officers to come help. And that's how Uncle Chip ended up there, which I think was a Saturday night because it was prom night for one of our guests back there at Yorktown, George Ferruzzi's. And in 1967, I always thought that these two events, 1966 and 67, that were discussed tonight, I always thought they were the most exciting events to ever happen in Arlington since Robert E. Lee decided which side of the war he was gonna fight for. So, and I grew up very close to Tom's Barbershop where the assassination took place. And for those of you who like to read, there's a book, it's called American Führer, and it's a very simple read. Lots of pictures about, you know, about Arlington and, or of Arlington and of Rockwell. It's a very good book. There are several about him, but that's the one I think is the most interesting to read if you like to read. So,
Frederick Signorelli is the author, and you know, I think Arlington deaccessioned it. I don't think it's at Central Library anymore. It was there for many years. Yes, this lady back here.
I'm Cece Michelotti. I'm a retired educator in the county. At one point, I did a research paper on the integration of the Arlington schools, and in doing that, learned that the Nazis invaded one of the school board meetings in the 50s when they were talking about integrating and starting at Stratford, and they raised quite a ruckus. It was in the newspaper at that time.
Yeah, that's true. And they had a lot of literature about the race mixing in the schools, too. That was a huge issue. And of course, it was a mainstream issue at Arlington. It wasn't just a fringe issue like some of the other parts of their agenda.
George Towner, I'm a little surprised at your description of the trial.
Hold it close.
In that, I believe I'm correct that Charles Stevens Russell, who went on to Supreme Court.
Yes.
I think he was the judge.
I believe that's right, yeah.
But what I'm wondering about is that you said he got 12 years for that. Was that a jury? I don't remember myself. That a jury?
Virginia juries, Judge Roussis will correct me, they deal with sentencing, am I right?
They did that.
Yeah. So I have it in my numerous articles, the exact sentence and the exact number of years that he served, but it's approximately that. Yes, Mr. Quinn.
Yeah.
This is a pure question.
Yeah.
Who are the people who were providing the funds for Rockwell, and what was their motivation, and whatever happened to them as a result of all the shenanigans you've been talking about?
Wow, that's a great question. So the two main funders were Harold Arrowsmith from Baltimore and a guy named Floyd Fleming, who lived in Anacostia here in D.C. And I think he probably inherited his money, too. And he bought the house on Randolph Street for Rockwell. Arrowsmith moved to Germany, and I think he was more upset about living side by side with blacks than with Jews, is my understanding. And it's interesting that he died in the 90s, and through the miracle of Google, I was able to find the court papers on his will, and he had made his money, his family had made the money in the Dun and Bradstreet business directory. It goes back to 1900. And the money kept getting passed down to generations. And there was a fight over the will in the late 90s. And a cousin named Arrowsmith, who had never met Harold Arrowsmith, lived in Fredericksburg. And he ended up becoming an instant millionaire with that money. I tried to track him down too, but not with such luck. So there was all these theories that they got money from world, you know, conspiracy people in Germany or you know, South America. But mostly they lived a very poor lifestyle. And there's an anecdote I have in my article. I don't know if you remember the Watergate detective. actor named Tony Ulasewicz, but he had a minor role in President Nixon's committee to re-elect the president. Well, he wrote a memoir, and that included his visit to the American Nazi Party headquarters in Arlington, where he went in there and it was just totally messy house with piles of unpaid bills stacked up and very unprepossessing. And the there's another memoir of a Rockwell aide who was angry that Link, as they called him, the head, he would gobble up all the what little food they had. And they all had to take odd jobs to make ends meet, and Rockwell himself never took any of the odd jobs. So, you know, he never had as much money as he liked the world to think that he had. And he and Aerosmith had a falling out eventually. It had to do with the fact that down in Atlanta, Georgia, there was a firebombing of a synagogue in 1958. And it got written up in the Atlanta Constitution and the New Republic. And Rockwell was quoted as saying that he wasn't directly involved, but he supported it, but he's in good shape because he has a fat cat backer. And that fat cat backer was Harold Aerosmith, and that led to their parting ways, and that's why he got kicked out of that house on Noyes Boulevard. Sure. Catherine.
Yeah, hi, Catherine Scruggs. I just wanted to check whether or not you can confirm, or maybe the fellow who was in third grade at Ashland School. We live in Dominion Hills on Liberty Street. And so when we moved in 1976, we were told by neighbors, I guess, that after the shooting, and of course we saw the swastika outside Tom's Barbershop was still painted there in 1976. Well, we were told that this guy who had shot him, the assassin, ran right down Liberty Street.
He does, yes.
And then so he dropped the gun in Four Mile Run there was pretty deep.
Well, there's a picture of the officer wading into the Four Mile Run. It looks like it might be a foot or two deep at the most. But his whole escape route is detailed in the news clippings.
Oh, okay.
You know, I can give you the exact streets, but I know Liberty and Livingston are mentioned.
Okay,
you know.
All right. Yeah. Thanks.
George Cranwell, back to your question. The creek wasn't very deep, because I spent a lot of time in the creek, too. I mean, it may have only been at the deepest place 3 or 4 feet, but most of the creek was very shallow. But I will say this. Forgot what I was going to say. Oh, evidence of George Lincoln Rockwell not having a lot of money is very true, because when you think about it, who would be doing their laundry at a laundromat if they had a lot of money that day? And that always seemed to amaze me. I mean, obviously he didn't have any money.
Yeah. Well, he also, the other thing he claimed in public, Mr. Quinn, is that he got money from campus speaking fees. But I'm skeptical how much money a college club would pay him. You know, he gave several famous speeches. Northwestern University was a big one, got a lot of coverage. The Nazis also traveled. They had a hate bus based in Arlington. They drove down through the Deep South, down to Alabama and New Orleans, and tried to intimidate the freedom riders from the Civil Rights Movement. They're very, very aggressive. Yes, Rockwell had about 7 children from 3 marriages. And in the will that I was given at the Arlington Deeds Office and Records Office, they showed all their names. And when I gave a talk on this at the Central Library about a year ago, a gentleman in the audience said that his high school teacher was one of Rockwell's children, but she was so embarrassed that she didn't use the name and didn't advertise it. A lot of them probably went back to Iceland.